Hello, it's Keith here, and this is lesson two of the platform-specific series of my 6502 programming tutorials. Now, last week we had a look at the BBC. We're going to continue now with the Atari 800 and 5200, and we're going to look at how to draw bitmap graphics on those systems. Now, the Atari 800 and 5200 are virtually the same system from the point of view of what we're looking at today. The only real difference is part of the graphics hardware is at a different memory address on the 5200 compared to the 800. I believe the reason for this was a sort of financial one, that they were two competing departments creating the two pieces of hardware, and they didn't want one department selling the software of the other because it would mess with their financials. And as a result of this, they both went bankrupt, so well done there, guys. So we're going to have a look at this hardware today. We're going to make some code that basically works on both systems, and we're going to just use some symbol definitions. So depending on if we're compiling to the 5200, we're going to define a symbol pointing to C000. But if we're on the 800, we're going to point to D000. The GTIA is the graphics hardware that handles the colors, but we also need the ANTIC, which handles some of the other setup. Now, when we define colors, we use these memory addresses here. These will vary depending on the system. We're going to use a four-color mode today, or also a two-color mode, but as well as that, we also need to use the initialization routines. Now, when it comes to defining a screen on the Atari, we need to use something called a display list. This is very similar to the lists on the Enterprise. Each line within the list defines the screen mode of a line within our screen, and we can also address different areas of the memory at different lines. Now, today's examples are just going to use very simple screens where all the lines are the same screen mode. But in practice, what you could do is you could switch screen modes to have different resolutions at different areas. And you could use this to save memory or have bits like the text in higher resolution than the graphics. But that's beyond the scope of what we're looking at today. Now, when we define our list, we give a memory address within our memory and we send that to the graphics hardware. But then we need to turn on the screen with the DMA control at this port here as well. So these are the ones we need to use to actually turn on our hardware. Now, the Atari 800 and 5200 have a wide variety of screen modes, but a lot of them are very, very low resolution. A screen mode that's 20 pixels wide and each pixel is 8 lines tall is not really going to be much use in a modern system. I mean, that might have been okay in the early days of Atari, but we're not going to look at anything that ridiculously low. We're just going to look at two screen modes in this tutorial today, the highest resolution two. One is 160 by 200 and has a total of 4 colours. The other is 320 by 200 and has a total of 2 colours. So they're the kind of resolutions of the Amstrad CPC, just with half the colour depth. So these are what we're going to be looking at today. And both of these screen modes use 7.6 kilobytes of memory. So they use quite a bit, but I think it's within the scope of what we can allocate to our game, because our games are going to be coming on ROM cartridges. So how do we define the screen we want to use? Well, as I've already said, we have to define something as called a display list. Now, I've provided a sample display list which will work fine for both the modes we're going to be looking at today. And the reason this works so well is both modes use the same amount of memory. It's just one has half the resolution and twice the color depth. So it works very well. You can see the definition here. There's a few bits of initialization. There's a restart command, but most of the lines are a screen mode definition. But we're using all of them as the same screen mode, and we're using this S mode symbol, which we're going to define elsewhere to be either E or F, depending on the color depth we want to use. Now, each of these commands is sort of split into two nibbles. Generally, the bottom nibble will define the screen mode, and the top nibble will be some other function. But there are some sort of special exceptions. The first thing at the start of our screen is we have to have an area for the V blank. This is defined by hexadecimal 70, and we're required to have 3 lines at the start. So these 3 lines have to be here in this format. Now, the next thing we're going to do is we're going to define the first line of our screen. The top nibble will be hexadecimal 4. The bottom nibble will be the screen mode, so in our case, E or F. But then following this, there are 2 bytes. These are the start of the screen in memory. The screen is made up of our regular memory, and this is then displayed on the screen. So to just draw things on the screen, we just poke to the memory, but we do need to define the area we're using at this point. It's in little endian, of course, here. So if we put BBAA in hexadecimal, the address will be AABEB. Now, that's not a real memory address, of course. The address we're really going to start at is hexadecimal 2060, and there's a good reason we're using that address that we'll learn in just a moment. Now, at the end of our list, we need to tell the graphics hardware to jump back to the start again, because the way it's working is as it's drawing the screen, it's repeatedly reading this list. So when we have the ending, what we have is hexadecimal 41, and this one isn't a valid screen mode, you'll notice here. But then we have the address of the list itself. So I've defined this D list here, which points just to the back of the start here, and that will loop around very neatly. But you'll notice there's an odd command in the middle here, and it looks very similar to the first command at the start. Well, what's that about? Well, there are a few rules that we have to adhere to when we create a display list. Now, the first one is the display list itself cannot go over a 1 kilobyte boundary. Now, I've got around this very easily. There's a sort of header at the end of the ROM files. I mean, I know it's not a header if it's at the end, but bear with me. Maybe it's a footer. This has to be at BFFD, and we've got the bytes for that there. But this means that it's a good place to sneak in our display list just before that, because we know that's going to be the end of our ROM. So let's sneak this in here. So that's what I've done here. And it takes far less than 1 kilobyte, so I'm starting at BF20, and that's enough space for this. Works quite well. The other one is a bit more tricky though. The data that makes up the screen cannot go over a 4 kilobyte boundary. The hardware that draws the screen will effectively wrap around back to the start of the 4 kilobyte boundary. So you'll end up with a screen that's showing the same information twice. This is a major problem because our screen is going to be 7.6 kilobytes. The screen can't automatically go over the boundary, but we can manually step over the boundary ourselves. Now, what we do is we use another of these hexadecimal 40 commands, and that's why we've got this here, and that's why we've selected this odd address 2060 here, because when we get to this point, we can now manually step into hexadecimal 3000, and that will fix the problem of the 4K boundary. It took me a little while to figure this out, and I was getting screens that were wrapping around, and I was drawing things to the middle, and they were appearing back again at the bottom, and it was confusing me. But then this will work just fine. Now, of course, if you were using different screen settings or you were moving the memory of the screen to a different location, you'd need to change this. But generally speaking, this code should work just fine for you. So that's how we actually define our screen. Now let's actually see it in action. So here's our full color display on the Atari 800. We've got our full color Chibico sprite. We've got some quite chunky text here, all very good. And here's the same on the Atari 5200. Again, looks exactly the same, no problems there. Now, in this case, because the two screen modes are using the same amount of memory and are very, very similar, I'm also supporting two color. So if I just unrem this mode two color here, this will force my code into two color mode. Now you can see that this is here and it looks quite good. Let's run it again. Now this is quite interesting. You'll see these two versions look very different. One's in blue and one's in yellow. Now my suspicion reading the technical documentation is that this is actually a bug in the 5200 emulator. My understanding of the documentation is that the foreground and background have to be the same color, but the foreground can be a different brightness to the background, which would make sense for this side because they're both blue, but the foreground's lighter blue. But this one is yellow, so I suspect it's actually ignoring that limitation on the graphics hardware at the emulator stage. Now, this limitation is only applying to the two-color mode. The four-color mode can have four totally different colors without any problem. But anyway, those are the screen modes we're going to be supporting today. So how are we actually doing things? Well, as with all of my tutorials, the sprites are being provided to us by my Aku sprite editor. This is my Chibico sprite here, and we can just export to these using this Atari 5200 option, and we can save a raw bitmap in two or four color mode here. So that's how we are able to get our bitmap. We're loading it in at the bottom here, just here, and it's actually in the same format as the ZX Spectrum, as you can see, so I'm just using that version there. And when it comes to actually drawing our bitmap, we're using this code here, but we're going to look at that later after we've actually looked at the code that's doing the work. Now, the main thing that we're going to be looking at is this getScreenPos command, which converts an XY coordinate into a memory address, and that allows us to write our data to that memory address. The other thing we need to look at is actually initializing the screen, because we've seen the list that we use to initialize the screen, but there's a little bit more work to actually get the screen working. So let's take a look at that now. So here's the code that actually starts up the screen. It's pretty straightforward. What we're doing is we're defining some symbols here. Now you can see in this header file here, we're defining some symbols, and we have to do this because, as I said before, the GTIA is at C000 on the 5200 and D000 on the 800. So we're defining these symbols to allow us to compile easily to the two systems. And you can see here, we're just adding the GTIA address to the offset within the hardware, and this is how we are able to define our colors. As well as this, we're using DMA control to turn the screen on and DList H and L to define the address of the screen. So here we're loading in the DList address, which is pointing to this here, and then we're loading that in. And then once we've loaded it in, we just need to enable the DMA here. And we do that by setting these two bits to one and just storing it to the DMA control address. That will turn our screen on. Now what we need to do is define our colors. So we're using these color definitions here to set up some basic colors. And I always tend to sort of mimic the Amstrad CPC colors. That's why we've got yellow on blue. But we do have some more advanced code, which we're not going to go into today, but we will go into later. And that's why we've got our Chibico in the proper white and purple colors that we usually expect with that character. Now, the Atari systems do have quite a good palette. You've got an entire range of colours you can see here, and you've got various brightnesses as well. This rainbow palette's very similar to the NES palette, and it should be pretty good for you in most cases. We are going to look at how to do colour palettes in a different lesson, however. So the more important thing today we're going to look at today is get screen pods. This converts an XY coordinate into a screen address so we can just write our data to the position we want. So we're using X and Y to define a location here, and then we're using get screen pods to convert that to a screen byte. And so here's the function here. Now, it's quite complicated, and this is because I tried to do some optimization to it to make it a little bit faster for Grime 6502. Let's have a look at the logic behind it. Now, our screen's very logically laid out in memory. Each line is 40 bytes. The lowest byte in that range will be the left-hand side, the highest byte will be the right-hand side, and the next line is just 40 bytes below the last line, and the next line, and so on. Now, when we come to calculate our screen, all we need to do is take the offset address, which is hexadecimal 2060, add to that 40 multiplied by our Y position, and then add our X position. So this would be all very straightforward, but of course, our 6502 doesn't have a multiply command. Now, we could just do a loop around repeatedly adding 40 until a Y counter got to zero, but that would be quite slow. So what we're going to do is we're going to do something involving bit shifting, which is going to be faster. Now, we want to multiply Y by hexadecimal 40. Now, hexadecimal 40 would have a bit 1 in this position and a bit 1 in this position. What we're going to do is we're going to load the Y position into the top byte of a 16-bit pair. We're going to use the zero page for this. And then we're going to repeatedly shift that to the right until the lowest bit of our Y position is in position 5 here. And then we're going to add that to a count. Then we're going to shift it to another 2, and we're going to add it a second time. The effect of this is we've calculated the Y position times 40 just by using a few bit shifts and a couple of add commands. So that's what we're going to do here. Now let's take a look at it in practice. So what we're going to do here is we're going to use DE for our running total, and we're going to use B and the accumulator as our sort of temporary variables as we're doing these shifts. So first what we're doing is we're storing X into E because we don't need that yet. And then what we're going to do is we're going to take our Y position and store it in B, and then we're going to store 0 in our accumulator. So effectively, our ZB 0 page address is going to be this part, and our accumulator is going to be this part. Now we shift bits along from B in the 0 page into our accumulator. We do this 3 times. So we've effectively shifted into this position here now. We then add the accumulator and B to our DE pair, and then we shift another 2. So we've effectively moved into this position now, and we once again add 2D and E here. Now, at this point, we've done everything with regard to calculating X and Y, so all we need to do is add our screen base, which is usually going to be hexadecimal 2060, but I have added an alternative where I'm simulating a 256 pixel wide screen where I just offset it a little bit to centralize it. So that's all there is to it. Now, we can also move down a line. All we need to do is add 40 to do that. Very straightforward. So that's really all there is to it. This code looks quite daunting, and it took me a little bit of debugging because of my horrendous mathematical ability, but I got there in the end. So this is pretty good, and I think it's reasonably optimized to do the job. So that's how we calculate our screen line. We're using Akkusprite Editor to define our bitmap, so all we need to do is get the bitmap onto the screen. And all we do is we load the address of the bitmap into our HL definition within the zero page. We load our XY position into our XY registers. We call get screen pos. This will set DE to be the position in screen memory that we need to draw our bytes. Now we're going to loop through until Y is the same as our width of our bitmap, and we're just going to fill bytes from the source to the destination screen memory, and this will draw one line of the screen. Now when we get to this position, we've effectively finished a single line. All we're going to do then is we're going to add the number of bytes we've just drawn to the screen to HL, which will effectively move our source position along to the next position for the next line. We're then going to use get next line to move our starting position down one line. This updates DE for the next repetition. So we're going to repeat until we've drawn all the lines of the screen. And that's all it takes. Now we do have some code here to actually set the colors up, but we're not going to look at that today. So let's see that draw again, but this time I've put a delay in it so it'll be running a bit more slowly. So we've started here and we're going to be drawing in 4-color mode, but we've not got the palette definitions because they're actually at the bottom of the file after the drawing's been done. So probably the wrong order there. Now you can see the Chibico being drawn. So this is the order the memory is, top to bottom, left to right. Now, Of course, I said before we could change screen modes here, so it'd be perfectly possible to have the top half in this 4-colour mode and the bottom half in the 2-colour mode, and that was something that you used to get done on the text adventures and things where there'd be some graphics at the top and the high-resolution text at the bottom. Perfectly possible with the Atari. It's just a shame that it does take quite a bit of memory to get it set up because of that display list. But anyway, you can see that's drawing quite nicely there, and there we go, so Chibico's in proper colours now. So there we go. We can do some basic graphics now on the Atari 5200, and it should be really easy for you to use this example and get started getting graphics to the screen. And of course, we've also got these text drawing routines that use the same code. Now, we're not going to go into the text drawing routines today. Basically, the same code, it's just been converted to use a 2-colour font, and it then converts that into the requirements for the screen. But anyway, that's all we're going to be looking at today. I hope you find this interesting. We're going to be looking at another system next week. Thanks for watching and goodbye.